Welcome and thanks to you all, to the readers, and to Book Warehouse, who's our official bookseller tonight. I'm Claire Kelly. I'm the marketing and production coordinator at New West Press. And we're here on Zoom to celebrate two New West authors and their latest novels, Danial Neil's Dominion of Mercy and Glen Huser's. I had to ask. I got caught up in what it could be. His Burning the Night. And I am convinced at some point tonight, I'm gonna call one book Dominion of the Night and one book Burning the Mercy, which are very intense, but not the books. Both authors will be reading from their novels and we will have a Q&A after. If you move your mouse around, you can see on the screen, there's a chat box, and that's where you'll throw your questions. I'll read them aloud, and the authors will most likely answer them. I give them the option in case they want to run away. As I said, we're recording the event. Cameras can be on, mics off, just so we don't have a lot of background noise. We're coming to you from Alberta, MBC. And we just want to acknowledge that the lands we are gathering on are the traditional gathering places for many Indigenous peoples. We honor, respect, and celebrate the history, languages, ceremonies, and cultures of the First Nations, Métis, and Inuit who called these territories home. I always feel it's important to think beyond land acknowledgments. And I've been lately finding links to charities that could use support, especially during the pandemic, but not only during the pandemic. Because both books tonight have a BC connection, I've put a link in the chat to the British Columbia Aboriginal Network on Disability Society, BCANS, it's the acronym. The money donated to them helps support programs and services to address the health needs of Indigenous communities and individuals within BC. My boss, Matt, is handling the links tonight, so there'll be links in the chat box as well, both to the bookstore. I have to scroll up, my memory is short. Book Warehouse, and the charity link will be there. Eventually, there'll be links to our website and stuff like that, so links galore. Up first tonight is Danial Neil. Danial Neil was born in New Westminster, British Columbia. He began writing in his teens by journaling and writing poetry. He took his first creative writing course in 1986 and worked steadily at his craft. I don't know how people work steadily. I'm really, I admire people who have a steady work ethic. He went on to participate in the Write Stretch program with the Federation of BC Writers, teaching free verse poetry to children. As a poet, I'm very happy with that. He won the Poetry Prize at the Surrey International Writers Conference 4 times and studied creative writing at UBC. His first published novel was The Killing Jars and then Flight of the Dragonfly was his second novel. And then another novel, I'm not sure, I don't have the exact numbers right. The Trees of Callan Gray came out in 2015. Dominion of Mercy is his fifth published novel and the one he'll be reading from tonight. Danial, though, has completed 20 novels, maybe more now since you sent me your bio, because that's an amazing number, since the beginning of his writing journey. He lives in Oliver in the South Okanagan of British Columbia. Welcome, Danial.
Oh, thank you so much, Clara. Good to be here. Did you want me to begin?
Oh, you're good to go.
Okay. Sorry, everybody. Right. Okay, I'm going to read a piece. Mary Stuart, the protagonist of The Dominion of Mercy. It's a period piece, 1917. She's a prostitute, forced into prostitution because of poverty. Her uncle banishes her from Edinburgh because he's an aspiring politician. She leaves behind her disabled father and little sister, and she's on a train bound from Scotland to Liverpool. And she's on the train and she pulls out a letter from her uncle who banished her to Antioch, BC, the farthest away that she could ever possibly get from Edinburgh. It's the farthest of the colonies. So, dear Mary, I will be brief with my instructions. The journey will be long, but you will reach your port of call. The ship awaiting you in Liverpool is the SS Missinabe. It also awaits Scottish orphans bound for Canada. You may encounter the women of the Salvation Army with their charge of young children on one of the coaches. It may serve you to travel with them, keeping them in your company during your voyage. I am uncertain of their ultimate goal. However, once the ship makes port in New Brunswick, you would undoubtedly will be on your own. When in doubt, ask. Find someone you can trust for assistance. You will travel across the country by train until you reach Vancouver. A ship will carry you north to your new home. You will need to rely on your wits, which I know you have in ample supply. I cannot say with any certainty that obstacles will not occur. Nevertheless, anticipate that certain adjustments may be required. I wish you good luck with a more wholesome vocation. I will ensure the welfare of my brother and niece. Sincerely, Uncle Calvin. I suppose he couldn't resist it. One more disparaging footnote, as if he couldn't quite comprehend poverty after all. And of course, I wouldn't be able to counter him that time. He was safe. But I must admit a renewed admiration for him. He showed a measure of respect for my acumen, and he would honor his promise to me. My father and Lizzie would be looked after. He must have realized that if he did not, I would surely return to torment him. And he did it all at his own expense. I must say that I felt more at ease now. I returned the envelope to my coat pocket. I surveyed the coach, assessing my company of travelers. It seemed they had all suddenly just appeared. A spectacled middle-aged gentleman reading a newspaper, news of the war. Several women with their spouses, no doubt. There were soldiers too, bound for glory. And the children sitting at the front of the coach interested me. They must have been the orphans. They were accompanied by two women in Salvation Army frocks, all royal blue and red sashes. Broad, stiff bonnets overwhelmed their pale faces. I considered approaching one of the Salvationists, offering my assistance. We were bound for the same country, after all. And then all at once, one of the children, a little boy, ran down the aisle in my direction and stumbled when the coat suddenly lurched on a bend. It was also very ordinary, a boy running, falling, and of course he began to sob. It seemed he had skinned a bare knee. I felt an immediate impulse to get up from my seat and come to his assistance. But before I could, one of the escorts marched up to him. She seemed to have no sympathy for the boy's misfortune and hauled him to his feet by one of his large ears. He wailed, of course. I saw no need for such rough treatment. I left my seat. "Excuse me, madam," I said, "but the boy only stumbled. Surely he shouldn't be punished." He looked up at me, his twisted mouth, his red hot ear, and the pink scrape on his knee. He had a name pinned to his coat, Gulliver. "You can mind your own business now," she said tersely, and then took a cursory look around the coach. The fellow passengers were all watching, heads up like pond ducks. She was a pasty-skinned woman without a grain of tenderness, her clamped hands squeezing the neck of the blubbering boy. "You are entrusted to the care of these good Scots children," I said, my voice rising uncontrollably now. "Do you know what that means, madam?" "You have nerve speaking to me like that, young lady." And then the other escort came up behind her, all warm mouth and smiling gray eyes. "Please return Gulliver to his seat, Agnes," she said calmly. It seems she was the overseer of the group. She waited until the boy was taken away by the huffing Agnes. "The children are very tired," she said to me. "They are beginning a long journey. Discipline is imperative for our homeless boys and girls. They must behave at all times. It is for their own good. But I imagine you are too young to know anything about children." "I suppose the self-evident elude you, madam, but I was one myself, you know." "You may call me Isla," she said, leaning towards me, her voice a mere whisper. "You are a tiresome girl, miss." "And you may call me Mary Stuart," I said. "Isla, then, did you ever think to console Gulliver with a kind word?" I noticed he looked back now and then from his seat, strained his sore neck to see what would happen next. It occurred to me just then that I may have inadvertently made things worse for him. But before I could concede my objections, I felt a heavy hand on my shoulder. I was spun around like a top. It was a man with a newspaper. "Miss, the children are being properly supervised," he said. He pushed his moist lips uncomfortably close to me as if he wished not to be heard. His fat tongue lolled, and below his chin a ruddy flush of jowl like a rooster's wattle. We cannot tolerate wretched foundlings on the loose. This is a civil society, and I am most certain that everyone on this coach will agree with me. Now, if you would please take your seat. I was stunned by his censure. It all seemed so unjust. I saw no reason for your rebuke, sir, I said. I wanted only to help the child. Now, what is the harm in that? He didn't answer, but strangely stepped back. I thought perhaps he couldn't counter such an incorruptible question, and then he began to inspect me in a rather shameless way. He seemed to be appraising me as if I were some commodity in a shop window. His fine clothes revealed a certain stature, perhaps a wealthy businessman, but I did not wait for him, whatever it was that distracted him, so I needed to get away from him, his dripping mouth, and return to my seat. But to my dismay, he quickly took a seat beside me. He leaned toward me, unwanted and scheming now. The train is bound for Liverpool, he said in a low, duplicitous voice. There are destinations for each of us. The children are destined for Canada. And as am I. Now I'll wager that you will be aboard the same passenger ship. Now I can see by the buttons on your coat and the men's on your sleeves that you're without the necessary funds to keep you out of steerage. They call it third class now, but the lodging is insufferable. On the other hand, I have excellent accommodation that I'm willing to share. And please accept my apologies for my uncharacteristic outburst. He placed a chubby hand on my knee. If you do not leave, sir, I will scream. Surely a shoulder porter will come to my aid. I've done nothing, he said, whisking his hand away. I have only taken a seat. If you wish to scream, then you must. Certainly the good boys will come to your aid. But as you can see, the passengers suffer from a certain malaise. They are a sleepy lot, wanting nothing but to be free from their misery. The train, they realize, takes them from nowhere. They care not for your circumstance. I'm only offering you an opportunity. I have unlimited money. I do this out of kindness. No, that isn't kindness, sir. It is repellent. I know what you want from me. I do not wish to continue this conversation any longer. I wasn't so pure, I knew. Many times I had consented to the solicitations of such a man with his soft skin and money. That very thing repulsed me now. I sat with that contradiction and watched the green valleys come and go and then dump for Shire where the trains collided and Paul and Robbie burned. I gasped as the train raced through without ceremony. I pushed away the tears. I wouldn't allow the man to intrude any further. I see the lovely rose on your cap, he said, and I must say that you look very attractive. He seemed to sense my sudden invulnerability. I suppose that is my shortcoming. I only want a companion, a bright young woman like yourself. What could be wrong with that? I do not want your company, sir. I would like you to be left alone. Please leave. You were traveling alone, Miss Stewart, he continued relentlessly now. I overheard you tell the Salvadors your name. And you are unlikely to tell me your name, sir. Ah, it all depends now, doesn't it? You are persistent, and you do not appreciate any of it. I only want to be of some comfort to you. And what is your business, sir? I asked to move him away from me. Textiles, I'm on my way to Montreal. Military uniforms are in great demand. I have several plants. Travel can be a lonely affair, you see, back and forth. Oh, so lonely. You insult me, solicit me with your wealth. Now you want my pity? I looked straight ahead, but felt the sudden rise of his bitterness and his discontent. I felt I had clearly frustrated him with my unfaltering rejection. You're a dangerous woman, aren't you, Miss Stewart? He said through his teeth now. I know your type. Never knowing when to be silent, always wanting a better stake for yourself. It's a nasty state of affairs, and that's the truth of it. It seems more and more that women have forgotten their place in the world. And I can see, sir, that you surely haven't. You may regret this. Are you threatening now? A sudden surge of alarm. It was the same sense of desperation I'd felt that night in Josie's flat in Dumby Dykes to escape from oppression and now from the evil disguise and the man's unwanted attention. We will be aboard the same ship for several weeks, miss. We may wish to reconsider. I wanted a moment with my brothers to remember them, that place where they took their last breath. The businessman robbed me of my own will, my solitude. I was tired of him. And then I remembered what Nurse Monk had said about Dr. Elsie Ingalls, how she campaigned on behalf of the women of Scotland. I had dissuaded him, get him away from me once and for all. And you may wish to think of this, sir, I said, turning to him now. There will be suffragettes aboard that ship. Do you know who they are? Yes, of course. I've read extensively of their methods. I find them very disruptive and disturbing, quite repugnant. I must say, nothing but criminals. That's a mouthful, sir, but you will not be able to tell which ones they are. Some don't want to be found. They have plans for Canada. I shouldn't be telling you this at all. You may despise them, and they may seem dangerous to the likes of you, but to your point, sir, you have overstayed your place in the world. Then a cruelly disguised smile. Do you think a gaggle of discontented women could frighten me? You underestimate them, sir. And it is true that most of the women have put their energy toward the war effort for now, but they will assist me if I ask them. They will come to my aid. If I am in trouble, it is the sisterhood that will change the world. And it seems, sir, that I must report your solicitation to the proper ladies. I wouldn't be surprised if some have had their ears bending our way at this very moment. They will do what they must, and believe me, they will. To your answer your question, their aim will not be to frighten you. Sometime in the night, they will come to your cabin. You'll be hundreds of miles from land. You'll be gagged and bound and carried to the upper deck, silent as mice. And they won't say a word to you, not a moment's hesitation before they pitch you over the rail into the cold, dark sea. They've done it before and they will do it again. Air rushed out of his sopping mouth. This is an outrage. Which part, sir, your vulgarity or the foretelling of your demise? Then I hope you are a good... I shall have you arrested. Then I hope you are a good swimmer, sir. You have no idea who you're dealing with, young lady. I made you a most honorable proposal, and I'll make you one. Never lay your hand on me again, and never say another word to me, nor look my way. I don't want trouble. I have a long journey ahead of me. Take your seat and read your newspaper, sir. He just stared at me. It wasn't with hate or even fear. It was the kind of look that comes from seeing something for the first time, a sunset, a storm, or the divine. A look of bewilderment and profound wonder. Something encountered without explanation. He was struck dumb and sat agog. But after a moment, he seemed to have found his decency at last, or perhaps it's only prudence on his part, and I would hope an introduction to compromise and better conduct. He regarded some of the passengers on the coach skeptically, the women, I was sure, then got up without further fuss and returned to his seat. I couldn't sleep. I fought against the lull and rhythm of the train, the flutter of light and shadow through Carlisle and Blackburn. There was only the strain in my limbs, my shoulders, a tightness in my jaw and a sickness in my belly. My vigilance was exhausting. Why did I have to be so? The man was rebuffed in the end. Was it my wit? It seemed a peculiar way to protect oneself. Why did I need it at all? And the anger I felt when pressed to despair was not a common anger. It was the rage that killed Jimmy McDuff. Thank you.
Thanks, Daniel. I will say, as a woman with ADHD, I've gotten in trouble a lot for intervening and stopping into situations before the alarm part of my brain has a chance to awaken. So I really appreciate throughout the book sort of Mary's the double-sided nature of her quickness, where she gets into trouble, but she's also quick enough to, like,
yes,
find a way at least partially out of trouble or temporarily out of trouble.
She does all the things that we would really, really like to do or like to say.
And yeah, but it's also the other side of that is sometimes she says the thing that we would like to say, but there's a reason we don't.
With the same tone, yes. Yeah.
I just want to let everyone know, remember to throw any questions you have about the books in the chat box. And we'll be moving on to our second reader tonight. Our second reader is Glen Huser From his earliest years, Glen has loved to write and read and draw and paint. He was a teacher and a school librarian for a lengthy career in Edmonton. And in his off hours, he wrote movie reviews. We got to chatting about movies before we started. I love movies. So yeah, we hopped back and forth about that. And he wrote that for a local weekly in Edmonton. He also wrote children's books reviews for the Edmonton Journal and got his small ink landscapes into galleries. For several years, he was a sessional lecturer at the U of A in Edmonton and UBC in Vancouver. His first novel, Grace Lake, which was a part of New West Press Noon Attack first fiction series, was shortlisted for the 1992 W.H. Smith Books in Canada First Novel Award. I'm always impressed about how long award names manage to be when I'm reading out a bio. He has written several books for young adult readers, including the Governor General's award winner, Stitches, and the GG finalist, Skinny Bones and the Wrinkle Queen. Glen's current home is Vancouver, where he continues to write as well as pursue interests in art and film studies. Welcome, Glen.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome everyone. Belonging to three book clubs, I'm becoming accustomed to Zoom meetings and its gallery of faces. It's delightful to see so many friends among the gallery tiles tonight. Friends and fellow readers, we are a family. Of course, my wish is that I could be standing next to you with a glass of wine. So I hope that you, like me, have one at hand. The next best thing. I guess like sex though, it's not quite as good by yourself. But I raise my glass to you. Cheers. I would also like to raise my glass to Danial and his new novel, Dominion of Mercy. I love historical fiction. And this is one I'm anxious to read. Congratulations, Danial.
Thank you.
So what can I tell you about Burning the Night? Well, maybe first of all, that it's doubly historical. And I feel obliged to reveal that the more recent historical aspect, Edmonton and Vancouver in the 1950s through the 1980s, is in many ways autobiographical. It's a little humbling to admit that one is old enough to be one's own historical novel. Like myself, Curtis in the novel comes from a little backwater town in Alberta, trains in Edmonton to become a teacher, and in the 1960s, after teaching a few years, studies at the Vancouver School of Art before returning to an Alberta classroom. I first began writing Burning in the Night in the early 1990s, following New West's publication of my first novel, Grace Lake. I had the good fortune to be able to work it with to workshop it with fellow writers in Edmonton, Katerina Edwards-Laverso, Robin Headley Smith, Sandra Mallett, Helen Rosta, Kay Stewart, Ilona Ryder, Greg Randall, Diane Linden. Thanks so much for your input. And my sister Karen's close reading as well as that of my New West editor, Sheila Pratt. Thanks also to Claire Kelly and Matt Bowes at New West Press for all you've done with the fine tuning and promotion. But getting back to 1993, I guess I didn't feel quite as historical then as I do now, a quarter of a century later. The other historical aspect in the novel is a look at Canada in the midst of World War I, particularly a look at what was happening in the worlds of art and music. Philip Periston in that time period is a young Vancouver artist studying in Toronto, where he befriends Tom Thompson. It will be 3 years before a number of landscape artists take on the name The Group of Seven. And the other central figure from this time period is Harriet Ahlstrom, a young woman from a rooming house on the waterfront who has been able to train enough to play a violin in orchestras featured in Vancouver soirees, where the upper classes sipped tea and nibbled petit fours while young Canadian men struggled through trench mud and gunfire in Belgium. Philip, who has some skill on a piano, falls in love with the violinist Harriet, and she is devastated when he leaves Vancouver for Toronto. So, a couple of strands that intersect. But I should mention one more. Curtis is gay, but very shy and unaccepting of his sexuality. Autobiographical? I'll never tell. Curtis gains a close friend, though, in Walter, another teacher, a gentle, patient soul. And shyness is definitely not one of his traits. Did I say Walter is patient? At times, I think he probably tires of Curtis reading aloud from a journal Philip Periston kept the year before he died, a journal that Curtis first reads in bits and pieces to his blind Aunt Harriet, and then has a copy made for himself. Enough said, but allow me to read a bit from the beginning chapter of the book. What was her age when I first saw her? 55? She was not that much older than my mother, a few years, but to my 11-year-old eyes, she was an old woman. I was one of those children, though, who are at ease with adults. And from that first visit, I believe we bonded in a strange, ineffable way. A spell was cast that caught me and held me for all the time I knew her and well past her death. Walter would say there are vestiges of it still, the way I frame a sentence, my affection for old bits of furniture, pictures, books from the time of the First World War, a violin piece that might well have been played in a Vancouver parlor as men waded through trench mud in the Somme. Ashes from the past, he says, the words edge with affectionate indulgence. Like Aunt Harriet, I had spent a good deal of my life in blindness, but a blindness of my own selection. In hindsight, I can see we were kindred spirits, the old woman and the young man with our dreams and denials. I remember visiting her only once before her husband, my uncle Hartley, died, and I left my own family to move to the city. My mother disapproved of Harriet Coleman. In her mind was the certainty that Harriet had somehow used her handicap to trap her brother Hartley into a fruitless marriage. It was a thought that continued to rankle over the years, that Hartley should have raised an illegitimate child and provided for a woman who spent most of her waking hours reading, tracing Braille characters with one hand while she chain smoked with the other. Hartley Coleman, in my mother's opinion, could have had his pick of women. Of the visit in question, perhaps because my mother would speak of it in the same voice with which she spoke of communist aggression in Korea and Catholic bingos in St. Paul, I recall a good deal. With my brother and myself in tow, my face still numb from the ministrations of a dentist in the Tegler block, we made the trip from downtown Edmonton to the south side. It was a day heavy with heat, slaked with the sound unusual to us of the continuous movement of traffic. After we got off the trolley, we straggled along a side street south of White Avenue and stopped at a small stucco bungalow. My brother and I fought over who should be allowed to ring the doorbell, an altercation that led to its being activated two or three times by flailing fists and jabbing elbows before we were cuffed away from it. At this point, my mother looked like she had spent the morning herself underneath the dentist's drill. She swept a strand of hair that had escaped from her church and town hat and fixed us with a look that indicated our weekly allowances were in peril. "Shit heel," my brother hissed in my ear. "Dink brain," I shot back, practicing the lip control of ventriloquism. A woman with a tea towel in one hand opened the door. She looked at us quizzically. "Is Mr. Coleman in?" My mother stationed herself in front of the two of us. "He is not home." The woman protectively blocked the door. "Can I do something for you?" "Mrs. Coleman, is she home?" We recognized a rasp edge to our mother's question. At home, we would have taken it as a cue to disappear. "Who is it, Jean?" The voice issuing against the soft heat of the early afternoon startled me with its clarity. Coming from the recesses of the house, it had the kind of definition and presence I associated with film actresses whose words drifted into the cocoon darkness of the Legion Hall in Yarrow on Saturday nights. "It's Violet," my mother shouted, "and Bradley and Curtis." "Oh my," the clear, distant voice. "Come on in, Jean, have them come in." We followed her to a kind of sitting room with its Venetian blinds drawn against the invasive sunlight of a southwestern exposure. It took a minute for my eyes to become accustomed to the filtered light. And then I saw Uncle Hart's wife sitting in an easy chair in the far corner. She looked like some kind of exotic alien creature to me, a creature with dark glasses, two bottle green eyes. Sure enough, she held a book open in her lap. Violet. She marked her place in the book with a piece of ribbon, closed it, and set it on a small round table at her side. Jean, this is Hart's sister and her boys. What a surprise. Hart didn't mention anything. Well, we didn't know ourselves that we were coming in, but Curtis had a bad toothache, and Mr. Jenkins, who runs the grocery store in Yarrow, was making the trip anyway, so we had a ride, and the dentist, when I phoned, was able to fit us in. He won't be going back today, but we'll catch the bus. Hart mentioned he was taking some time off this month, and I thought maybe that this might be one of the holidays, you know, and we get to see him and you, of course. The boys have only been to the city once before, and we've none of us seen where Hart lives. Our mother was never one to run on. I think both Bradley and I listened to this spill of explanation with something close to amazement. Aunt Harriet rose from her chair. And while she couldn't see our mother, she divined where she was standing, barely in from the door. Tall and long-legged, it took the blind woman only a couple of steps to reach her and wrap her arms around her in a hug. Mom uttered a little gasp. Her own hands, one clutching her purse and a shopping bag, remained at her side. Hart did take holidays, but he's out of town for a couple of days, fishing with his sales manager. I'm so sorry. Aunt Harriet released Mom from the hug. Please find a place to sit. The woman who had let us in, Jean, moved some mending from the sofa and nodded towards a couple of upholstered chairs. The next few minutes of conversation were lost in my sudden and pressing concern to find a washroom. Bradley smiled angelically, but with evil knowledge, as he watched me squirm and cross and uncross my legs. We were invited up to Aunt Harriet's chair so that she could trace our facial features with her fingertips. Bradley has his uncle's jaw, she decided. By the time she was ready to feel my face, I was so in need of a facility that no part of my body would remain motionless for even a second. For heaven's sake, stand still, my mother said. He's got to pee, said Bradley. I was grateful that Aunt Harriet could not see the shade of crimson I was turning. She laughed, a tinkling, beautiful laugh that was nearly disastrous to my bladder. Jean was called and I was shown to the bathroom tucked between the dining room and a bedroom. I inhaled the smell of scented soap and tobacco as I relieved myself into the shining porcelain and water of the city commode. Running water had not yet made its way to the street we lived on in Yarrow, Alberta. When I returned, I heard my mother saying, after all this time, we keep expecting you'll come with Hart when he visits. I'm not a good traveler, Aunt Harriet smiled. It seemed she was about to say something more, but instead she put the cigarette to her mouth again, and for a minute there was nothing but silence and smoke. Tell me about yourself, Bradley. Aunt Harriet had finished her cigarette, and removing her glasses, massaged the bridge of her nose. The removal of the glasses made the network of scars that covered her face more noticeable. Oh, Bradley gurgled and looked desperately at our mother. Bradley loves sports. He's a lot like Hartley in that way. Hartley was the best baseball pitcher around when he was younger. I had trouble imagining this. The few times I'd seen Uncle Hartley, he seemed to have trouble moving his huge frame at a walk, never mind a run. And Curtis? Oh, Curtis is our scribbler, always writing something or doodling pictures, my mother laughed apologetically. We generally depend on a person's eyes to indicate interest, but somehow Aunt Harriet managed to do it with her body. Her head craned forward, her hands grasped the arms of the easy chair. You write and draw, she said. I nodded and Bradley kicked me in the shins again. She can't see you jerking your dumb neck. A little, I muttered. There was a tingling feeling in my lips and the freezing began to wear away. After this initial chapter, the narrative continues 6 years later, with Curtis starting his teacher training, becoming on Sundays a dinner companion to his aunt in Edmonton's finer restaurants. Evenings that end with Harriet sipping brandy while she listens to Curtis read aloud from Philip Periston's journal. Sunday concerts at the Jubilee Auditorium. hours spent teaching junior high in the city, and eventually a reconnection with university classmate Walter spill against entries from Philip Periston's diary that take us all across Canada. Burning the Night invites you to follow in the footsteps of both Curtis and Philip on journeys shaped by war and suppression. And of course, Blind Harriet's refigured journey of remembrance. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I really chose the parts you chose. And one thing I've been thinking about a lot lately is how differently we have to connect with each other. And I love the way Curtis is kind of pulled into connections, both with his aunt and with the diary and the past and sort of the world the diary opens up for him. It just feels right to read a book about connections right now with everything that's going on. So thank you for writing the book that I got to read multiple times while working on it.
Thank you.
Again, questions in the chat box. We do have one question already from the audience because Jacqueline shows up to play. but I'm going to ask a question first to break the ice, and then I'll be copying and pasting your questions so that I don't lose them in the track of the evening. So both of your books deal with the time period of the First World War, generally the home front. Partially, as you said, it's a sort of a double historical narrative for you, Glen. But what drew you both to that time period?
You want me to go first?
Yeah, you guys can arm wrestle. This is always the first question, right. Is getting those, yeah.
I was always interested in family histories and the community histories that we have. And actually, my mom worked on a community history and wrote up the family stories of many of the people where we grew up. And reading these over, it was so interesting to see how many of the young men had been had gone overseas to fight in Passchendaele and other of the battles that Canadians were very involved in. And even in our family photographs, there were photographs, old photographs from that period of people, friends of my grandparents. And, you know, so I had a lot of questions about World War I, and we studied it in school, of course, too, and knew the tragedy of that trench warfare and so on. So just being drawn to history, that and the Canadian connections was sort of what got me fairly interested in it. And the book that I have published just before this one, Firebird, actually deals with the Ukrainian internments that happened in Canada during World War I. That was another interest that sort of perked a little bit as I got more into my adulthood and found out some of the things that had happened during World War I that Canada was connected to.
Yeah, it's amazing how much family, like I feel like our historical memory of families very often leads to World War I. Like one of my great uncles was the youngest Chelsea pensioner because he went off to World War I when he was 14. And that's kind of a family story like that we know. But yeah, Chelsea pension is the pension for World War I in England. So yeah, it is amazing like how much, especially 100 years after, 100 and a bit, how much it's still very relevant this time period.
Resonates, yeah.
Daniel?
Historical fiction just happened to be the vehicle to tell a story that I wanted to tell. I was interested in immigrant stories, and I only knew one immigrant story. It was my ancestors that came from Scotland. That I could tell. I could tell with some accuracy. And also my grandfather was a miner in Phoenix, BC. He was sent to this mining town of Antioch in British Columbia. It's on the Alaskan BC border in about 1916. So I had connections. So the immigrant story I decided to tell was going to be from Edinburgh to Antioch. And I needed a woman because I was raised by strong women. I wanted a strong female voice. She ended up being a heroine. But I didn't, I write contemporary fiction. I'm all over the place. I write, I enjoy whatever is important. Certain parts of it, like Glen, I mean, certain parts in our history are important. We need to know them. We need to understand them. And if we can even see how we've evolved, it's difficult today to see if we've evolved at all. But if you always look back on history, you can see certain places where we evolved. One of it was the suffragettes and stuff. So one of the great things about historical fiction is the things that you learn that you didn't know before. We all know our Canadian history and the history of the world, more or less, that we've taught through school. But when you dig into some of the research, that is, to me, the rewards of fiction. And at this time in 1917, the world was in a mess. You know, that hasn't changed so much. And, you know, women were just emerging. And I had to use the historical context to give a woman, in contrast to male dominance, to it was, pretty much a male society. So we needed a contrast, and I gave my character a sarcastic wit to sort of amplify where women were at, where we were at in that period in our history. So historical fiction is just suited the story that I wanted to tell.
I think different time periods are resonant at different, depending on what's going on, for sure. Like, with the US political stuff, I was obsessed with the 70s for a while because I thought we were redoing the 70s. Yeah. And then when the pandemic started happening, I ended up reading this book about sort of the history of Bellevue Hospital in New York and how we kept saying things were unprecedented. And it wasn't, like, we've done this. So like the Spanish flu in 1918, or like the first, yeah, the various outbreaks in New York City that the hospital had to deal with, and the hospital being overrun. Yeah, it's amazing how much, and I found it comforting, like, to know that people had gone through something similar and had survived, you know, or like had more than survived, like just survival isn't the goal. But yeah, no, that makes complete sense. Glen, so question from Jacqueline. Mm-hmm. She says, your intro was wonderful. You mentioned it took quite some time to complete this novel. Can you go into more detail on why it took that long to complete?
It actually didn't take that long to, well, I shouldn't say that, because I did a lot of research. I read the Vancouver, on microfiche, I read the Vancouver Sun for all that period of time to get that correct. And read books on Canada's, you know, part in World War I and so on, studied Toronto history a bit and some of the other cities involved. So there was a lot of research that went into it. But the draft itself, the first draft, I probably finished in a few months. And then I submitted it to a publisher in the early 1990s, and the publisher was interested, but sat on it for about 2 years. And by that time I started to write some of the young adult fiction. And so I thought, well, you know, if it sat for 2 years and there were no takers on it, I just put it away in a drawer in one of my filing cabinets. And so it wasn't until, you know, close to 20 years later that I kind of got, you know, poking through my filing cabinet and pulled it out and reread it and thought, okay, you know, I think there's something here. And so I did, you know, work on polishing it and reworking parts and so on. But it's essentially the manuscript that I did write back in the early 90s. And I mentioned the workshop people that did give me feedback at the time, which was very valuable. But I don't know why it sat so long. I guess I was busy teaching. I was busy doing all sorts of things. And sometimes it just takes energy to get books out and, you know, do all.
Sometimes they need to sit.
Yeah.
I have a poem in one book. It took me 12 years to get to the point where it got published.
There you go.
And I did accidentally skip you. I got overexcited with questions from the audience. What drew you to the time, like the World War One? I'm not sure if you just touched on that in your answer or...
Sorry?
Did I already, I've lost track of what I'm doing. This is what's happened.
Yeah.
You went first, World War One. Yeah. Suddenly blanked out. It's okay.
And we talked about
that. Okay, I'm okay, everyone.
It's been a long day here.
I did tell Danial earlier that I'm going to be the silly one. So you guys are like going to come off as like writers, like serious writers.
Oh, very good. Thank you.
I don't know. That's a scary thought, Claire. Yes.
Yeah. I don't have any more questions in the audience, and we're not going to make Jacqueline do all the work tonight. She has at an event asked all the questions before. This is a bit of a two-parter question for you both. I always ask this people who write historical fiction because I try to think about how one does it, because I've never done it. So part one, do the gaps in history allow you the space to put fictional elements into history and sort of create a narrative out of it? And two, with the present being more documented, do you think there will be enough gaps in history for future writers to write about the time period we're currently living in? I just think of all the reams of tweets that those writers will have to read.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Danial.
Well, historical fiction, it does have that advantage. We've got such distance that we got a bit of freedom. Contemporary-wise, I find one thing difficult about contemporary writing is I don't know what to do with the cell phone, with my characters. Right, because every tension, every challenge, every question you have, you can look it up, you could Google it. So I'm like Longmire, you know, and my characters, I want them to not have a cell phone. But I think in the future, when we look back to today, there will be the same distance and you will find your lane. That's what I do with historical fiction. You know, I pick a lane, I can't rewrite history book, or I can't tell this broad story. So I bring it in to this narrow lane and research it and add the contextual historical elements as the foundation. And I'm sure that's gonna happen in the future. It'll just be somewhat different. And they talk about the gaps in history. Yeah, I mean, those are kind of the sweet moments where we can insert characters, especially with Mary Stuart. Today, we probably have a lot more of that going on. It wouldn't be so sensational, but a historical fiction allows it to be sensational because women weren't allowed, they were suppressed, they weren't allowed to have attitude, they were kind of put in their place. So historical fiction is valuable for that. I couldn't tell that story today because it would just come across as, you know, some, you know, but this is what I love about historical fiction. It does allow you to do that.
I'm writing horror and I watch a lot of horror films. And oh, the amount of cell phones that they just have to destroy now, like, oh, battery's dead. Suddenly you're like the cell phone phrase, because it's very hard to have a horror film when you can just look up what you're dealing with or phone someone. Yeah, it's a challenge for sure. Glenn?
Well, I think as writers, you know, all the historical frameworks are there. But you create your own gaps and you fill those gaps with characters. And I don't see any problem with that at all. But, you know, the context is there. You just have to figure out what's an interesting take on it sort of thing. How the the problems with our future. I can't think about that. It's giving me a headache. Go on to the next book.
That's fair. I'm like, writers predict the future. It's unfair, but I want it to. So Katarina has a question for you, Glen, because you weaseled out of that one. Okay. Is the Halifax explosion still in Burning the Night?
Thank you, Katarina, for a spoiler alert. Because I structured the novel so that actually doesn't occur or is mentioned until the last few chapters. You probably figure it out, but it is a little bit of a mystery why Aunt Harriet is so scarred, or you know, has lost her husband. Her significant other.
I will say, to defend Katarina, I've read the book four times while I'm working on it, and it still works the fourth time. So, like, it's not going to ruin your reading of it, I swear.
Actually, Katarina has read it before, so I need to have a conversation with her.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So another question. I like the questions. It's my favorite. Like, I love hearing you guys read, but like, I am in a condo, not big space, and I don't get to talk to that many people. So this is like one of the really fun parts of it. Danial, we've been describing Mary Stuart as if Anne of Green Gables was Scottish and grew up on the tough streets of Edinburgh. She's really fun to see get into trouble and then get out of trouble, or partially out of trouble, or whatever happens, or temporarily out of trouble, as I said. How did you discover this character, or did she discover you? And what about, you mentioned a bit like about how you wanted a female presence in this masculine, but like, were there other elements of her character that created contrast besides her femininity? Like, maybe her job or something like that allowed you to explore aspects. I gave you a hint.
Well, you know, to me, I got a different approach to writing. I have an idea, I have a vision. I sit down and I just sort of, it's almost inviting the muse. I don't have a outline, I have a rough plan. I sit down and the next thing you know, I'm writing in first person. At the first page, I was in her body. I feel like it was channeled. Every time I'd stop writing, and the next day I would say, what happens next? And I just wrote for the first thing that comes, and I wrote it in 7 months. And one draft with little editing. That's just the way my writing works. And all my novels are like that. I don't have writer's block. So she wrote the story. I wasn't, because if you think about it mentally, you're constructing something. So there's some other element in the universe that sort of fuses with our creativity. And I don't know how that works, but to me, that's what it feels like. Because otherwise you're hammer and nail, you're constructing something. And my writing doesn't work like that. It's a kind of like a channeling almost. I clearly can't explain it, but so I let her. It seemed like I wasn't constructing her. It was just comes out in the narrative. And it was, after a while, it gets a momentum. So I knew exactly how she's going to handle every situation and creating situations to give her that place, that voice. So you got to constantly be doing that. You got to be constantly introducing a challenge. It's usually a man for her to respond to. And it's got to respond, you know, it's just entertainment. You know, you want to be entertaining, you want to be, I try to create a tension in my work, a fuse of tension throughout the whole thing. So you're always wanting to know what happens, what's Mary going to do next. And so that's how I did it. So it's not really, I don't have it thought out, but to answer your question, basically, she wrote the story through me. It's just, I don't know how other way to explain it.
Yeah, I write poetry primarily, and that's kind of, I get the rhythm in my head and then I go. but I've been working on a novel, and that's plot. I love plot. Because it's horror. I love plot. I as you've noticed, I'm a bit so I need it. But I'm so impressed when people can just sit down and do that. It's amazing.
Yep.
Glen, you mentioned did it feel writing an autobiographical novel? Did that feel different? I don't know, your first novel, was it autobiographical in aspect? Are all novels autobiographical in a certain way? How did it feel to work on this novel when there was a connection, a direct connection like that?
I think a lot of my novels have had bits and parts and bits of me in there. Not so much, a little bit in Grace Lake, the first one, because it's based at a lot of it is in a summer camp. And my parents used to ship my brother and me off to a summer camp. It was kind of, I think, punishment for being alive. But anyway, so there was some of that. I mentioned the things that were autobiographical in this one, but it's mainly just, it's not that the character is all that much autobiographical, at least somewhat, but you know, you pick and choose what you want to. I probably make the character way more interesting than I ever was at that. So, so bits and pieces of my life, but also the invented life of Curtis.
Yeah, I don't know. I think they have to be parts of you because they have to be parts of what you can imagine in a certain way. Liz has a question. Danial? Did you do much research about the settlement of Antioch, or was that based on sort of family history or experience of other mining towns?
Oh, thanks for your question, Liz. When you first came up with Antioch, I had my family history, which is very vague. My dad told me about his father. He worked there. He didn't say much about it. My dad's father died when my dad was 13, so. But I knew he worked there. And so I don't have no details about my family in Antioch, so other than he was a diamond driller. I created a town based on hundreds and hundreds of photographs. There's quite a store of archival material to draw from. So I saturate myself with the details of the mine and how it operated, how it worked, and then the steamships. I just saturated myself through research until I can actually feel my way through it and insert my characters in there. So the city of Antioch is a town. 3,000 people live there. It was real. I just inserted characters into it. So there's no family context other than my grandfather worked there. And that gives me a bit of license, you know. It kind of gives you a little bit of an authentic edge that I had family there, because it's been a ghost town since 1935 and 43, it burnt down. So I thank you for your question. Thank you.
I think there's a lot of people of mining family. Like my grandfather went down the mines at 14 in Jarrow, Northern England. He was a coal miner. And then there was the Jarrow March, which was like a big historical event where the mines were getting shut down up there and they marched to London. And it was a big protest. And it's like, if I was ever writing a historical novel, my grandfather didn't go. I would want to write a historical novel about a character who doesn't, like the unforest Gom, who doesn't go to any like historical events, who somehow misses them while they're all happening. Because that's my family story. They didn't do those things. My dad tried to go to Woodstock, but couldn't get across the border, for example. So it's like, yes. it's interesting how many people I know have connections to these things. That it's only when you get to chatting.
You know, one of the things, Claire, is that British Columbia is founded on ghost towns, resource-based towns that are no longer around. There's nothing, just historical photos. But to bring something back from the dead is such a fun thing. I mean, writing's got to be fun. And to me, that is so much fun. You just like, you get to be God, so to speak. and that is so much fun.
Oh yeah, no, I have fun doing it. Yeah. Like, well, if not, I'm just watching baseball and knitting right now. So like, I have to do something else too. Glenn, do you plot and write every day, or how does your process work?
I think out the book a little bit. I don't really, you know, sketch out a plot on paper or anything. I kind of know where I want to start and more or less where I want to end up. And sort of like Daniel, I kind of let the story find its way. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you end up on some interesting side trips and so on as you go along. But no, I don't work from a very sketched out plot. It's pretty amorphic as from one chapter to the next, how one thing leads on to the next thing, to the next thing. So
you don't have a spreadsheet like me then.
No, I don't. and I'm not a very regimented writer. Once the momentum gets going, I can write for hours on end, and other days I probably will dither around and procrastinate a lot. I like to write in restaurants. We talk
Must
about
be writers, hard right now.
Yeah, you talk about writers in residence. I always used to call myself writer in restaurants because that's what's where I'd take a long foolscap. I wrote longhand generally to start with, and then I would type up whatever chapters I had developed, and of course you revise as you type up. But so I don't have a hard and fast way of so many pages a day or anything like that.
That gives me hope, because I'm glad I'm a professional. Like, I can procrastinate, even though like I worked with you guys on your books and I make the schedule. That seems so alien to me, my brain. So we have one more question, and then I think we'll, unless someone throws a question in right now. Oh, someone did it just as I said that. Grumpy, aka Roy, asks, out of interest, why the name Mary Stuart? Are we to look for references, elisions, parallels, coincidences, or could it be as easily Mary O. Strabitsky?
It's just a name that I came up with. There's no, I didn't need any mythology to come up with it, methodology to come up with it. It's just what came to me.
I it is a common name too. It's like a Claire Kelly, for example. Like there's lots of us.
Yeah. Yes.
Last question. If a movie were to be made of your book, Daniel, which actress would play Mary? And Glenn, who would play Curtis? And it doesn't need to be current actors or actresses.
Yeah. All right. Everybody has seen The Crown. Miniseries? No.
We're not royalists.
There was a character. It's a fabulous series. There's a character that plays Princess Margaret. Her name is Vanessa Kirby. She was outstanding in that role. She was outstanding. A really compelling actress. Yeah, you know, that's who I think. Her or Claire Foy, who played Queen Elizabeth. So those two characters, an outstanding show, and the acting was stellar. And that's what I would choose. She would be my first pick.
I had a pick. I picked two. Maggie Smith, a young Maggie Smith, would be really good. Like, she had a lot of spunk in the prime of Miss Jean Brody. So I want her to be younger than that and less of a fascist. That's what I think.
Okay.
What about for Curtis?
Well, I've been thinking about that because you posed that question earlier to us, and I think bringing actors back from the dead is such a nice idea. I would choose Brandon DeWilde, who was the young man in HUD. He was Paul Newman's young brother, and he was just kind of a nice, gentle soul. And I kind of think that Curtis is a little bit like that.
Yeah, it's,
maybe him or Anthony Perkins.
I was thinking a more contemporary Anthony Perkins, Neil Patrick Harris. Like, yeah, he can play quieter and softer. Like, I just think, like, Curtis in some ways feels very young. And I think because he played the child doctor that I was thinking someone, yeah, like, I don't know why he feels so young to me. Like, he feels younger than his age a lot of the time in the book, but,
yeah. Well, he is still growing up throughout that
book. Yes, yes. But I mean, like, even in the sections where he's an adult, I think it's an interesting coming of age novel, the whole book, because he's coming of age into adulthood, which, yeah, I'm in my mid-30s now. I don't feel like I have it figured out. So, like, it makes sense to me that he is coming of age into adulthood.
Okay.
Innocence. Liz says innocence. Yeah, he's an innocent, open, and as you said, like, just a character that is not going to hurt. Like, he's not interested in hurting anyone.
Yeah, exactly.
So Matt's throwing up some links. As I promised you, there would be links galore. There's links galore. I'm just going to do my closing remarks now, everyone. Thank you all for being here, and to the authors for reading, and for all your great questions. It always helps when the audience has a lot of questions. we have one more event coming up this spring so far. There may be more, so keep an eye out. Next Monday, May 17th, Edmonton Poet Laureate Nisha Patel will launch her debut collection with guest reader. And this is as of last week. He's an award-winning poet, Bertrand Bickersteth, and he's out of Calgary. Please visit our website, newwestpress.com. There's one W with that. The link's right there. The events are on our event page, and it has the Eventbrite, how you got here, basically. It's got the information there. And our social media links are there as well. It's one of the good ways to follow what's coming up. But you can also sign up for our newsletter on our website. That's another way to be in the know about these sort of events. Thanks again, everyone. And as I always say at the end of events, remember, if you can, please continue to support small publishers and bookstores of any size. We wouldn't be here without you all. Have a great night, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Yeah. Great to see everyone. Yes.